My dear friends and dear Professor Karakaya, welcome to our final presentation. I am Tom from Computer Engineering Department and our team members are Aysu from Software Engineering Department, Roshna from Computer Engineering Department, Rıza from Electric and Electronics Engineering Department and Galipan from Mechanical Engineering Department. Next, please. We will begin our presentation with information about our dataset. After that, Roshna will talk about the explanatory data analysis. Continuously, me and Roshna will show the pre-processing steps according to decisions we made and show initial model results. Then Rıza, Aysu and Galipan will explain hyperparameter tuning and model selection with three different algorithms. Finally, we will complete our presentation by showing the algorithm we chose and why we chose it in our conclusion part. Next, please. Our project name is Flight Price Prediction and our dataset is taken from Kaggle.com with 300,261 distinct flight booking options and 11 features. What we are trying to achieve here is to be able to predict our target value. This project will be supervised learning and regression models will be used. Next, please. When we looked at the raw data, we first removed the features called Feature 1 and Flight. These extracted features are uniquely defined for each sample and have no effect on the model. Next, please. When we view our raw data using the data table widget, we see only two of our nine features are numeric and the remaining seven are categorical and prices are targets. Now Roshna will continue with the explanatory data analysis.
Next slide, please. Hello, I'm Roshna. I'll talk about the ADA part of our dataset. First, I'll talk about why we didn't use binning. Binning is a technique used to convert continuous values to discrete values. But we decided that it would not be suitable for our model because dividing the data into certain groups can cause loss of information and detail in the data. Next, please. First of all, we can see the most important and unimportant factors that affect our target value, which is the price in the correlation map. The four most important values are class, airline, stops, duration, respectively. Next one, please. You can see the source city and destination city distributions in this table. There are flights departing from every city and landing in every city, and the distribution of all cities is quite balanced. Next slide, please. Only Air India and Vistara are two airlines that fly business. As can be seen here, Vistara makes the most of both business and economic flights. For this reason, the airline company with the most flights is Vistara. Again, the most expensive flights belong to this company. For companies that only operate economy flights, we can see that AirAsia is the cheapest airline company. And also we can see that the SpiceJet is the company that makes the highest priced economy flights. Next one, please. Air India and Vistara have the widest price range because these two airlines offer both economy and business flights. Since these two companies sell mostly economy flights, their median values have shifted to the left. When we look at this economy and business separately, we can see that very balanced data again. Now, Tom will continue with the pre-processing part.
Next, please. I will start pre-processing by introducing our base model. Due to its compatibility with our model, we performed our pre-process steps using the decision tree. The goal of using decision tree is to create training model that can use to predict the class or value of the target variable by learning simple decision rules. In other words, if-else conditions inferred from prior data. As you can see on the right of the screen, we did not interfere with decision tree widget by leaving the settings as default. Next, please. First, we encoded categorical features and converted them into numerical values.
May I interrupt you?
Yes, sir.
I wonder if you try with very shallow tree with less number of depth, and did you get the rules from that after training? Did you print and check the rules? Because in your two slides ago, Roshna tells us something about the price ranges, expensive and cheap. Have you checked that your simple decision tree can accurately understand this relationship and then create simple rules for handling the prediction. Have you checked
We didn't check it specifically, but because we get rather good results in R-square and MIE values, we thought that decision tree made good decisions for predicting the price.
Yes, I
But we
understand.
didn't
But
specifically.
if you wonder what the rule of how many rules it learns, right, from the data, which widget would you use to see these kind of rules? Can
I
you?
mean, there were widgets. I don't remember specifically. Something tree. I mean, showing something tree.
Yes.
I guess that one.
Galipan, do you remember that widget? To visualize the decision tree, actually each node we have some decision, right? According to some feature, and it is special value.
I remember
Galipan.
it, but I don't remember the name, sir.
Okay. Aysira.
Me too, sir. I don't remember the name.
Don't either.
If I
Rıza.
wasn't mistaken, the name of the Weaver widget is the Tree Weaver widget on the
Remember.
visualization part. But the when we try to visualize it, the features and their values are writing so little, so it's not giving a clear view on the if we try to
Check it.
measure it on the
Or
yok when we put it on the presentation, the writings are getting so little, so it isn't showing a good
okay,
understanding.
Roşna.
No, I didn't remember the name of.
If you go previous slide, okay. So here your the three orange default values right here.
Yes.
So limit the maximal tree depth 100 here, right? So you would
Yes.
say, for example, just for experiment, let's say that it's five. Okay. Then you can just see the resulting tree, decision tree, and check the rules, right? So by your
Yes.
eyes, by using some orange tree widgets, there are some, right? So
Yes.
in your final report, I would like to see, even for as a just experimental purposes, with a simple tree, what's the result of the rules? You try to write these rules, and there are some other widgets to convert these three to rule base, right?
Yes.
So please do it in your final report.
Yes, we will.
Okay.
I just remember the example you gave in the class with
Yes, I
the
did.
şey,
Right.
but
Remember?
we didn't. I remembered, but we also talked about this in EDA presentation. But as Rıda said, because it's 100 trees depth,
Evet, but
we
100 trees
didn't
you
get.
cannot, ya, as a human being you cannot follow all these. But for just experiment reasons, let's make it five maximal
Yes.
tree depth, and then five steps, five levels you can understand as a human being, right? So you can
Yes,
follow
we
the tree,
will.
and you can create the
Okay,
rules by using other widgets. So try to adapt this information to your final report. Of
okay,
course.
we will.
Let's
Thank you.
continue.
Let's continue with the encoding. Yes. First, we encoded the categorical features and converted them into numerical values. Encoding is a technique of converting categorical variables into numerical values so that it could be easily fitted to a machine learning model. You can see the final version of our data in the bottom of the screen. Next, please. When we look at the results as train and test, although our R-square values are good, we have very large errors. The reason for that high MIE values is that Indian rupee was used for price in our data. Next, please. Then we.
Tam, as we discussed in the last time for
Yes.
hyperparameter tuning and model selection, in the
Yes.
previous slide, are you sure that you need to use the test data or the validation data?
I mean, we are in the pre-processing, not on the hyperparameter
So
tuning.
even for the pre-processing, you have to use the validation data, okay? Because if you do the pre-processing according to the test data, then it could be also a cheating. Do you understand? Because you are
Okay.
doing everything. So the test data must be used only for the test reason, not for the pre-processing, not for validation, not for hyperparameter tuning, not for, do you understand me? So test
Yeah, I
data
understand.
must be unseen. So if you use test data to decide which encoding you would like use, then it is actually you are doing some cheating because you are seeing the data that not must be seen before the test. Test
Okay.
means that actually you decide everything about your model and your
Okay.
data. Okay,
I understand.
please change this in your final report as well. Use
Okay.
only validation for pre-processing as well. Okay,
Okay.
please note this. Okay, let's continue.
Okay. Then we only scaled our duration and days left features between 0 and 1. In addition, we have converted our target from Indian rupee to British pounds so that our mean absolute error values are more universally understandable. You can see the latest version of our data below. Next, please. Here you can see the orange tree image. Since the scaling method will need not be applied to encoded categorical features, we have divided the data and then merged it to its final state. Next, please. When we compare the results of our finalized data only and only the encoded data, we can see that nothing has changed in the R square values and our MIE values has become more understandable. The reason why R square didn't change is scaling our data does not change the relationship between the variables and therefore does not affect the R square value. In most machine learning projects, encoding and scaling methods are used as a basis step. Next,
So,
please.
so Tom, in your last presentation, we have
Yes.
different mistakes here. I think you fixed the mistakes here, right? So now
Yes,
you see
I
that
did.
it's much more understandable, right?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
It
Okay.
means 6 pounds cheaper or expensive.
Yes, for
Yes.
example, right?
More
Okay.
understandable, yes.
Okay, let's continue.
Next, please. Now I'd like to start by trying an approach with data split. Although it is not exactly a pre-process steps, we have seen that we have achieved a more uniform distribution by only taking economic class. We analyzed whether we would give a better results by giving it to the model in this way. Next, please.
But for a little bit clue for your presentation in the previous slide, you use some black numbers, black
Yes.
scale text. You see that left and right. So we
Yeah.
cannot read it, right? So make
Yeah.
it either white or the background must be white. Okay. We cannot
Okay.
read on the paper. It's not going to be easy either reading these kind of things. Okay. Be careful.
Yeah. Okay.
Continue.
As we've seen here, we compared the test and data results by dividing them into three as the whole data set, only economy and only business. Although train yielded lower MIE results in the only economy part, our R square values dropped drastically. At the same time, we can interpret that overfitting has occurred because we get worse test error values in this way. As a result, we decide to use the whole data set, not the splitted one. Next, please.
May I
Then,
skip that position in the
yes.
previous slide? Because Roshna tells us about that according to the, some airways companies, there are
Yes.
different price ranges. You think about this business and the economic class, and then you
Yes.
train two models, right? You split the data. Did you think that maybe it's not a good idea in real life, but for your data set, just for your data set, did you think that split the data according to the similar flight prices according to flight company?
I mean, we thought about that, but as you said, it's not applicable in real life problems. So we think that in only one model will be better for our project.
Okay, continue.
Then using the feature constructor widget, we analyze the difference in values by performing operations between two numeric features we have. We didn't include it in our final presentation just because the model was slightly worse in all combinations. You can see all the results in detail in our report. Now Roshna will continue with feature selection.
We choose the decision tree as the base model while we haven't done anything other than scaling yet. Our data set train and test rate look like this. When we will show whether the values will get better by processing the values by feature selection. Next one, please. We then use one of the feature selection methods, which is lasso regression, to find features that are less important than others. Since we have few features, it wouldn't not be good to use lasso regression, but still we try to show the values. The lasso regression algorithm changed the less significant value for our destination source city respectively, and the results were like this one. When we're comparing the data with no features extracted yet, in the train section the error values increase and R square values decrease. In the test section, we can see that the error values increase and R square decrease. We abandoned this method because the values declined when we removed even the most insignificant feature.
Roshna, may I interrupt? Did you expect that result, these results? I mean that if there are, I don't know how many features we have, 10 features, right? 9 features, almost. So if you apply the lasso and try to reduce the number of the features, actually, indeed, do you expect that the performance of any model would increase?
No, we knew that it will decrease the values, but since you said that. I can see the like values if it's good or bad, it doesn't matter. So we wanted to show this, but we expected that.
When the lasso regression could be used as a feature selection method, in which data set you would like to apply lasso regression as a
if there's a lot of features, we might like get rid of some of the unnecessary features, but since we have less features, like 9, it's
yes,
not
correct. Correct. Okay, thank you. Please continue.
For us.
Please continue.
We also tried the key best method, and it was worse as we expected. Therefore, in general, feature extraction did not contribute to train and test rate of the data set. We could not get any efficiency from the pre-processing methods that Tan showed in the previous slides too. That's why we decided to continue with the data itself without adding or removing any features. Now our other group members will talk about the hyperparameter tuning and model selection.
Hello. In this page, you can see the hyperparameter for the hyperparametering tuning, how we split the data. As you remind in the previous presentation group, we did not also split the data into three different parts. We use as a single data set. So we will remake the calculations by splitting in the three different sets, and we'll write it on the report. So for the first model we choose a lasso regression method, which is most preferred in the numeric variable data. So in this page you can see how we create the different alpha values, measure with different alpha values, and take their results. So in this page you can see the alpha values go smaller on the graph, on the chart on the right. As the alpha values is higher than the value of 1, the test R-square result is getting lower and the mean absolute error is getting really higher. And after some point, at the point of 100, the R-square becomes 0, which makes all of the features equal to 0. So the result is not true. But as
May
we
interrupt here, Rıza?
Yes, okay.
When R square is zero, what you would understand?
I understand. I need to explain the working principle of the lasso regression to explain this. So lasso regression is decreasing the unsignificant effect variables to zero while calculating the...
No, I am not asking alpha. I am asking R square score.
I missaid it. So
R square is zero. What does it tell to you about your model?
The model is not processable with this model, and it's zero or negative. There is a problem in the creation of the model.
So what so, we say this? How we learn?
It has to be redone by changing the maybe the variables of the model to check if the model is correct, working correctly, or remaking the model.
Galiba. When R square is zero, what you would understand? How can you comment on your model?
I don't have any comment, sir.
Okay, Tom.
I guess it's zero because lasso works in a way that takes every feature.
It's not related with lasso for any machine learning model. If it is a regression problem, if R square is zero, what you would tell? What you comment on your model? It's not related with lasso, with any model.
Okay.
If R square is zero.
And we always said it didn't work, but
no,
I
it
guess
didn't.
There is an explanation.
No, work is just the English term, but it's not we are looking for. Aysira?
If R square is zero, it means that the model does not explain any part of the variance in data set.
So what it means?
So model has no power on the dependent variable.
So do you remember that we have done some experiment with R square with simple model and I share it on the model and predicted values. I did something on the predicted values and we see that R square is almost zero. Anybody remembers this? Roshna?
I think it means that our model cannot predict well.
No, it's not related with prediction well or not. There is a specific word for it. And Rıza, you
I
couldn't get it?
That.
Rıza?
I think I don't know the specific word you are searching for, but
remember that when your model predicts constant values, R square becomes zero, especially when this constant value is the mean of your target value. Hmm. Anybody remembers? We did this experiment with the regression matrix Excel sheet. Remember? I shared the Excel sheet to experiment mean absolute area value, mean absolute error, mean square mean absolute error, remember, and R square, remember? And there I showed that if your predicted value is always the mean of your train target values, then your R square is zero. So basically what it means that your model always predicting the same value, right? For example, in your problem, it's always saying for any flight, $100. for example. Always.
Yes.
Right? That was the answer I am looking for. And we did it in the on the class. Okay, let's continue.
So from the graphs and our observations, we choose the alpha point equal to 1 is the best hyperparameter for the lasso regression, since after the point of 1, the r square and the mean absolute error values are start to changing significantly, and before the num value of 1, the mean absolute error and r square values are almost the same, as you can see on the second graph. The alpha values are almost the same, then the graph itself is making a exactly equal line. So I need to discriminate the lines as a dot and slash lines to show that there are two different lines on that exact same places. So on the next page, you can see the results done in the unseen part, and our mean absolute error value on the unseen data is equal to 45.092, and r square equals to 0.904. So my friend Aysu will continue with the AdaBoost tuning and model result.
Hocam, Aysu's PC just froze and she's trying to rejoin. Can you ping him?
I did several times, but I think she got some problem. She attempts to join, but several times she couldn't succeed. I don't know.
I think she's trying, but...
Aysu, are you here? She seems to be here. Aysu?
Okay, she's here, but she's muted.
She has the same microphone problem, a similar one, at the beginning of the day too. We fixed it, but it may be broken again.
Okay, so what we are gonna do?
We can pass this section.
Yes, we can continue with Galipan. By the way, meantime.
Hocam geldim. Geldim. Duyuyor musunuz hocam?
We can hear you.
Okay. I will continue. Now we are continuing with AdaBoost algorithm. Next, please. Here you can see the orange tree view. Next, please. We had three hyperparameters. These were the number of estimators, learning rate, and regression loss function.
Aysu, next, can you please turn on your camera if possible, or do you have a problem?
I mean,
it's open.
It's on what?
It's okay, let's continue. We have 9 minutes only. Okay, I don't see, but okay.
Okay, next, please. And now for the tuning on number of estimators, by keeping the learning rate 0.1 and the function linear, that is by default, we get the values from 1 to 100 by looking at the mean absolute error. We choose the fit estimator as 100. And continue. Next, please. Secondly, we tuned with the learning rate for the 100 estimators, and here we continued with a value of 0.5. Next, please. Finally, we tuned the regression loss function and got the best result in the square function. Next, please. Here is the result after all hyperparametric tuning. We got these results. Next, please. Now, Galip will continue.
Hello everyone, I am Galipan. I will continue the presentation with random forest model tuning and result. Next, please. As you can see on the slide, there are four different parameters that we can control the random forest model for tuning purposes. On the bottom of the page, you can see the untuned model result with validation test data. We may say that there can be a little overfitting and memorizing. Next, please. I started with the arranged number of trees. As you can see in the graph, there is not much change in the mean absolute error in terms of number of trees, just a little difference. So I select the number of trees as 20. Next, please. Then I continue with the number of attributes considered at each split. As you can see in the graph, as I activate the button and decrease the value, mean absolute error values for train and validation tests start increasing. As I increase the number, mean absolute error started decreasing, so I select as 7. Next, please. Then I arrange the depth of an individual tree, so you can see the difference between the depths of on the graph, and details will be given on the final report also. So I select the depth of an individual tree as 25. Next, please. On this page, you can see the graph of required subtest splitting number and mean absolute error comparison. As I increase the number, mean absolute error start increasing, but the difference between train and test decreases. So I select the value as 15. Next, please.
Galipan, there is a typo in your heading. Smaller.
I didn't understand, sorry. You can.
In the figure. Do not split subsets smaller.
Yeah, okay, sir. I'm sorry for that. I see now.
You will correct in the final report.
Of course. On this table, you can see the untuned and tuned model result together as a final comment. We think that we have more generalized model after tuning. Next, please. On this table, you can see the tuned model result with unseen test data. The results are shows that we have small difference between test and training results, and the model looks like okay in terms of mean absolute error for our team. Next, please. Here is the orange tree flow of random forest model tuning. Now, Rıza will continue with the conclusion part.
So for our final model selection, among these three different models, we have chosen random forest because in the difference of mean absolute error in the ADAboost, the train mean absolute error is really small, like a 4.1 pounds, and the test a 10.7. 15 pounds, but the difference between these two values are so much that means overfitting. So we choose random forest, and for the reason of why didn't we choose Lasso is the high value of the mean absolute error and the lower R-square value, like
Rıza,
about 10%.
May I interrupt here?
Yes.
Okay, thank you for the presentation for the final model selection, but it's a good habit to provide their hyperparameter values along with the name of the models, okay?
I can say the values. In the ADAboost, the learning rate of 0.5.
No, I am not asking again, but it's a good idea to present the model with the hyperparameter, selected hyperparameter values. Okay. In your final presentation, Lasso, what, which Lasso model? Because the hyperparameter is important, so you decided about it, right?
Yes.
Please,
alpha is equal to 1.
In your final report, please provide this information along with the name of the each model. Okay.
The reason why I didn't put their values on this page is that there are a difference of their
okay, Rıza, just
variables.
Go next.
So
okay.
So for the final model, you can see their graphs and the values of the random forest values. So that's all for the final model selection. The random forest has 20 number of trees, 7 splits for each attribute, and has a depth of 25. And the data will not split if their value is under 15. So to closure, I would like to call my team leader Galipan.
We made some mistakes during our project studies, but we never give up and we try to continue learning and working. As a team leader, I would like to thank my group members for their precious work. Also, we would like to thank Professor Dr. Murat Karakaya for the feedback that he gives us during our process. I hope you enjoyed our presentation. Thank you for your listening.
Okay, I thank for all the group members. I have a question. In the previous slide, you mentioned that you have selected the random forest model, right?
Yes.
I have a very quick question for everyone. Let's begin with Aysu. Aysu, do you think that we can get some rules from the random forest?
Could you ask, please? I'm sorry.
I am repeating my question. Do you think that you have already selected and trained the random forest? After that, can you get some rules from the random forest saying that if X is greater than blah blah, do this, the price would be this or not? Can we get these rules in orange, especially three?
Yes, we can.
Okay, Rıza.
If I am not mistaken, the random forest is not applicable with the tree weaver. So I didn't try to get their methods on orange tree. So I am not sure.
Okay, Roşna.
Well, I'm not sure about that, so I'm not going to say yes.
Galipan.
I also, I'm not sure.
Tan?
I didn't specifically get the question. Are you asking the tree weaver decisions or rules, or are you asking if you put like manually our flight?
Whatever you understand, can you get some decision rules from random forest?
Okay. I get like if I manually type my flight number or something, destination city, it will give the price for
actually, you know that random forest is consist does consist of many other decisions.